about Black August. I'm part of the second generation of those that came up in prison after the comrade was assassinated. I stand on the shoulders of comrades like Sundiata and Shujan and all the rest of the comrades. When I came into the prison, when I came to prison in 76, that atmosphere, that revolutionary atmosphere, that spirit of resistance was still there. And it was after my generation that they began to lock up a lot of the brothers. We all started going to SHU around the mid-70s. I went in 78 and was released, and I reported to prison in 82. And one of the things that was really poignant for me was being in Solidarity with Owain on the yard with WL and the other two brothers were murdered. And knowing that they're right next to where they were, or right next to where they were murdered, was the hospital. And Alvin Miller in Cleveland, that was attempted to take, to move WL Nolan over to a gate that they could open up into the hospital when they were shot and murdered. So their murders were intentional. There was no effort to try to, I mean, they were basically set up. The white guy that was shot, he started a fight with WL because the state wanted WL, had wanted WL for some time. So being in that yard for 2.5 years before I was transferred, first to Vacaville and then to San Quentin, that was real. That was something that wasn't lost on those of us that were there, that were part of the movement. It was in 79 in Solidaridad Owain where we initiated Black August commemoration. And the spirit of resistance, the fervor among them brothers, still exists today. After I was locked up, those that was also in the SHU when I left continued to remain in the SHU for an indeterminate period of time. They came up with this in, I believe in 80, they came up with the indeterminate SHU program where you didn't have to do anything to get locked up. It could be something as innocent as having a book that they had decided was illegal, that they allowed to come through into the institution and then turn around and charge you for being in possession of it. It could have been something similar to what we used to do in terms of our Swahili, learning Swahili. They outlawed Swahili. They outlawed anything that was considered black, you know, and they labeled it as gang activity. So most of these brothers, when I left in 82, I had no idea that they would be warehoused for the next 30, in some cases 40 years. It wasn't until these brothers collectively, across racial lines, decided that they were going to unite and challenge their condition of confinement in the SHU program. And they held two hunger strikes, and they got the attention of people in the street, they got the attention of politicians, and a class action lawsuit was filed. And in 2015, they began, actually before 2015, they started the fifth and mile to the main line. And so now that they're on the main line, I'm able to talk to a lot of them. And the spears are still strong. They've endured a lot. I mean, being in a 5x9 cell for 30 years, is, you know, and surviving that, it was tremendous task on their part. But they're clear, they're still part of this fight, and they want people out here to know that they're still supporting. Are we getting close to the location? Okay, should I stop? All right.